restaurant in Manchester that many of you might not have heard of before. And I'm going to introduce to you a couple of chefs that I think you're going to be hearing a lot more about in the future. Guys, who are you?
I'm Mariella McCake.
I'm Lawrence Tottingham.
And your restaurant is called?
Aumbry.
Prestwich. Fantastic. How long have you been here?
It'll be 2 years in October.
Yeah, 2 years.
Coming up
for
2 years.
Okay, so everyone knows, everyone in association with Visionary Dining knows that one of my missions, one of my tasks, one of my visions is to identify emerging talent. I've just had the most remarkable lunch with some textures and flavours that will live long in the memory.
Very good.
What's your background?
Well, I started an apprenticeship at the Charbet Hotel, and that's where I met Mariella. Mm-hmm. And that's where it all started, really.
Yep.
And we went off and did a bit of travelling and ended up working for Heston Blumenthal at the Fat Duck. And I helped open Heinz Head up with him when that happened. Mariella did a lot of work with Heston as well, doing historical research.
Oh, it's, yeah, it was Susha. And yeah. Then did a year working doing historical research and development for Heston.
Okay, and did you enjoy working for Heston?
Yeah.
Amazing.
Fairly mind blowing experience, I'd imagine.
Yeah, he's a very inspirational person.
Completely inspirational, yeah. And taught us so much, not just about cooking, but you know, about an approach to business as well, really.
Yeah.
And
it's so normal as well, and a very approachable person to work for, not your usual.
Yeah.
Usual tyrant, as it were, if a kitchen and everything like that. I mean, he was just a good boss.
Really, really enthusiastic about teaching as well. Just would stop everything. If you had a question, he'd stop everything to make sure you got the full answer.
So where did you get that work ethic from in your career? Where did you first? Was it from people like Juan Martin and Colin Acree?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it started at home with working, cooking with my dad, and that's how I really sort of got into cooking. And then Charabay was just such a good start, but those two guys were fantastic, you know.
So you worked at Charabay, and then you moved on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we went to the States, didn't work anywhere, particularly interesting, just sort of worked in a resort. In Missouri for
That was nearly a year. Connected to the college I was at the time, as I left, and then just
this happened in another interview last week, actually. Yeah. For those who, I think there's a prize here for those who know who else's phone rang in an interview recently.
I know it was Tom Aikens.
Oh, well done,
yeah.
Well done.
Yeah,
like
sorry.
It.
Sorry.
No, that's everyone. Fine. I think mine. I always have mine on time. Anyway, so. When did you realise that this was the industry for you?
Pretty early on for me.
Yeah.
I mean, I fell in love with it very quickly. I mean, you know, it's tough when you first start. It's really tough, and I think you pretty quickly know whether or not this is something worth doing. If you don't love it, then there's no point putting the hours in and the effort into sort of. You know, improving your skills and all the rest of it. So I very quickly sort of decided this was what I wanted.
May I ask really, really politely how old you are? Or in fact, if I ask you, I would ask a lady if you tell me how both of you how.
I'm 30.
Right, and
Maryland's 32.
So you're really young still.
I'm glad you think so.
And you're cooking some cracking food for that age as well.
Really?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're cooking food that most chefs are in development still at that point that you've obviously nailed. So that's.
We feel like we are in development really. We're just starting,
of course,
just starting to get a feel for what we want to cook and you know how we want to present things, and it changes all the time. It evolves all the time. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you're a husband and wife team.
Yeah.
If what you put into your food is an extension of your personality. Mm-hmm. How would you describe your food, and how would you describe your personality?
Question.
Well, I think the food. I think this makes it slightly idiosyncratic. Is that it's that like the read of it on the menu and the sort of the sound of the food is very, very old-fashioned actually. It's very kind of sounds quite simple, but there's a lot more that goes on with it behind the scenes.
Without doubt.
So that's it really. We're not very showy. We don't like to be loud and sort of say, you know, sort of describe things too much or sort of, you know, we just like to sort of keep it really simple on the menu, and then hopefully what we deliver is a couple of surprises or, you know, a bit more interest than people are expecting.
Definite emphasis on the sort of produce you can get around here. I mean, especially for us in Lancashire, it's an absolute goldmine for suppliers and produce, which it should be celebrated in the Northwest, in my opinion.
Yeah.
You see it all the time, and especially around London and the South where we've worked before, and you do see it up here a little bit, but not as much, and I, you know, for one would like to be part of the kind of campaign to really push that into sort of the mindset of the nation and get people sort of turning their heads from London up north to see what's going on up here, because there's so much good stuff around, you know.
Oh, there is without a doubt. In fact, so, there's a lot of people saying that London's gone really off the boil at the moment.
Really?
And certainly, you know, tell me about the challenges of taking Michelin-esque food and dropping it into the suburbs of Manchester.
Well, first, most people complain about portion sizes. That's, I think, quite a northern trait.
For a couple of months, and then it stopped, and I think the people just stopped coming that wanted portions.
Yeah, and I think it's been well received, to be honest, and people are just out to look for kind of just good, honest food, and that's what we're trying to deliver, really, with a few little surprises if we can in there, which will stand out for the people who remember it, and that's it. But it has been well received. Yeah, there's definitely like a clean, well, it's definitely a market in the Northwest that would.
We have a lot of locals actually, and I think the reason they come is because we don't scare them off by being too serious about it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a lot of people haven't really heard of us, they don't know what to expect. So we try and keep it quite relaxed out front, you know, sort of quite low-key. But then hopefully the food delivers sort of, you know.
There's a great deal of articulation and technical skill in your food. And we're not talking about technical skills where you're having a go. This is stuff that's been mastered. And that's when I'm just getting to your age here. That's an accomplishment. When did you begin to realise in your careers that you could begin to boss food the way that you do, and you know it's going to turn out right? You know, that place I had today, for example, was absolute perfection. That takes grace. So when did you realise that you could sort of like cook to that standard?
Well, I suppose I didn't really know that covered. Still feel like we're just sort of having a go, sort of working on everything. But I suppose the fat duck was it, really, was the turning point.
Yeah.
I mean, when I started there as a chef de party, I'd never really dealt with foie gras before, you know, and there was a lot of stuff. I'd never used a water bath. I'd never heard of jalangum. I'd never, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on that I'd never come across before. So obviously that we learned a lot of skills there. But I think what we learnt more actually is the approach, and that's just the approach that a dish really is never finished, and that you never stop looking to make it better, and you never stop trying to improve, and you know, you taste absolutely everything, and you keep tasting it, and you don't, you know, sort of assume nothing.
And taking the ingredient and looking at it and just thinking what you can do with it, just stepping back for a minute and just to have a look, and don't assume that just because lamb and mint has always gone together, that's what you should always do, is, you know, just try everything.
Yeah.
And try it 10 times in different ways.
You have to develop.
Yeah.
You have to do it. You have to sort of like develop dishes sort of back of house before you deliver them, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
When diners come here, they're going to discover that there's a great spontaneous fresh edge on your flavours that I would say industry palates are going to really enjoy that. There's not much about in Manchester. There's great menus in Manchester, and there's great dining rooms, but it's your subconscious flair and your muscle memory that is like delivering that real cutting edge, that last 2%, I believe.
Cool.
How do you feel your customers understand that?
I'm not sure they do, to be honest. I do feel like a lot of what we do goes completely unnoticed, which is fine if they enjoy the meal, you know. But that finish that we try to do, that, like you say, that last little, those last few touches, that we really put a lot of effort into doing, I suppose it'd be nice if someone noticed.
I was told that the first place wasn't right, and yeah. What was wrong with that one?
It was just slightly overcooked.
Right.
It had got to about 50 degrees.
Yeah.
Are you using water baths?
Yeah.
Sous vide?
Yeah.
That really tells in you. I mean, like the pigeon, for example, that's going to be. So what kind of temperatures are you cooking that at?
Pigeons to 56.
Yeah.
And the sole should have been 42. Should have been 42.
Incredible. Great flavours. I mean, you're obviously using a Thermomix.
Yeah.
All the textures are so smooth.
Yeah.
Are there any other like pieces of kit that you're going to be buying soon?
Well, we've got the nitrogen gas on the horizon.
We have tomorrow.
Liquid nitrogen, I should say.
Liquid nitrogen?
Yeah. It's coming tomorrow. It should have been here today for your lunch. You should have had a slightly different dessert.
What, you order that through like BOC, do you?
No, it's not. It's a company, I think they're supplying the Fat Duck currently. They BOC won't really supply to restaurants. They're not keen. So there's a chap and Mansfield Cryogenics, and he's very helpful, and he comes and does all the health and safety bits, and he supplies in reasonable amounts and with reasonable sort of regularity, so it's really helpful for restaurants. Mm. It's good guys.
Yeah,
how much do sort of MSK products play a role in your cooking?
Yeah, hugely. We get
it doesn't. I think it's there, and we use it where we feel it's necessary, but we try not to overuse it because it's very easy to get carried away, you know, with spherification.
Oh, I suppose, yeah, we definitely try not to do stuff for the sake of it, but I think that last 2% you were talking about, the sort of finish, it's there in a lot of things, like, for example, using malic acid in the apple puree just to give it that lift.
Yeah.
Things like, I suppose all the sort of spherification stuff we use.
So there was like a bubble, wasn't there, on it?
Yeah, the jasmine and honey for the...
That was amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of thought I could be eating that.
Did you?
It was right out there in the middle of a field somewhere.
Yeah. That's brilliant.
Really, really balanced harmony in that. And then I think it was on the goat dish, you had a bit of...
Yeah.
Madeira gel, yeah.
Yeah, that was like a hot jelly, was it?
Yeah, it's a jelly.
Yeah. So those things, I think you're using them really, really sensibly.
Yeah, we try to. I mean, the point of having these amazing ingredients there is that you can just deliver a flavour in a slightly different way. It's not there for show or for...
That's right, it's another delivery.
It's another delivery mechanism.
Yeah. So in terms of, are you making all your own stocks?
Yeah, okay.
I mean, that's certainly our like philosophy from day one, was like, if we're going to put it on the menu, we're making it from scratch, from the bread to the oatcakes with the cheese to the chutneys.
Really?
Everything, yeah. Absolutely everything. And...
We don't buy anything.
No, that's definitely one of the major points. Like the Rowan jelly we have, the rabbit terrine, you know, we've just foraged the Rowans recently to make that jelly. And,
the elderflower in the jelly.
Yeah, so
the jelly
was just gathering things from around us just to do that. I think that's the way to do it, just to...
What supplies are you using there, and what are you using for like fruit and veg and that?
Wellux, fruit and veg, fantastic.
Very helpful.
Very interested.
Yeah.
Fish?
A couple.
We're using using C&G Neves and LMJ. The other veg guy we use is Brian Idden from Bury Market, his stall there.
He's brilliant.
When he's got his stuff on during the season, like now, Hesketh Bank stuff is really nice.
Really fantastic.
Like this morning, like the cauliflower yard, that was from there this morning, and things like that.
He does the samphire, doesn't he?
He just
all anything you sort of that grows in Lancashire, he either grows it himself or he gets it. So
during the game season, you can get anything you want.
Yeah, anything.
So just like coming back into the industry, how you have a young family,
mm-hmm.
So you have a couple of kids aged.
We have two sons aged 3 and 10 months.
Mm-hmm. Wow, you've got your hands full then.
Yes.
That is really mental, isn't it?
Yeah, it's mental.
Yeah.
That is pretty poor. And you're working, 14 hours a day as well, then?
Well, I work a bit less, obviously, having the children.
Right.
But we kind of... Yeah.
Yeah, we balance it out.
And we have a very healthy family.
Actually, I mean, that was the whole point of another point of starting the restaurant, really, not just because we love the industry, but to try and make a family life, work as well, and I think doing that, working for other people, it's harder to do that. As if you do it for yourself, then you can organise your time a little bit better. And that was one of the points of doing it. And,
Where are you both from?
I'm from Bury.
Yeah, I'm from Cumbria, from North Lakes originally.
Oh, right, okay. All right, fantastic. That's so that's the sort of link to Sharrow Bay.
Yeah. It's just sort of people sort of heard of Heskett Newmarket and Colbeck. It's a little village near there.
I know it.
Sebrum is the name of the village it came from. So, yeah.
Fantastic. Yeah. So, why did you pick here then?
Well, we moved back up from we left Fat Duck, moved back up to Manchester just to sort of get a house. We got married, you know, and we started looking all around Manchester for a restaurant. We live 5 minutes away, and this place came up for sale. So
there's a lot of friends here and family as well, so it's a nice place to be on that side of things.
It was definitely a wise move, moving closer to family.
Where do you see your future?
Here.
Yeah.
Be nice to redecorate things. But, you know, I think
we'd certainly like business number two.
Yeah, we would.
Nothing massive. I don't see us rolling out into hotels or anything like that, or big restaurants, but you know,
probably
I think you've got to keep your options open as well. So I just have to see.
Do you network in the industry, or do you feel you know, quite central in the industry, or is it because you've got a family in here that it's just pretty like blinking?
I think basically there's no time outside home and the restaurant to do very much, to go and eat at places, to sort of be involved in that way. So I think that's probably
worth mentioning. How did we meet?
On Twitter.
Yeah.
I thought you were asking how we met.
No.
We'll be at the show.
We did meet on Twitter.
Yeah. Sorry, he's there. Yeah, so we met on social media.
Which
is, and do you find that quite useful in sort of just like having a few questions here and there?
Yeah,
and
I do.
It's been really good. I mean, you've been more involved in that than I
have.
It seems to really help Twitter, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has. It's been brilliant. You know, met some, obviously yourself, and had a chat with Fergus Henderson the other day. And
really?
Yeah, and nice guy. And Simon Rogan answered a question.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, he was really helpful. I had a question about, somebody put a picture up of a dish, a long plume dish, and I had a question about how it's done, and he answered very candidly.
Yes.
We harvested some birch syrup at the beginning of the year from the trees around
here. We sent that out to Jeremy.
Conversations on Twitter,
yeah.
So that was quite funny.
Right.
It is. It's brilliant. It's just fantastic. I can't believe I've only come across it so late. It's just such a
fantastic tool. Well, as a result of that, and the great lunch, and obviously ongoing discussions, we'll be joining the Visionary Dining family.
Yes.
And getting involved in all the bits and pieces that we're going to be doing, and you'll be meeting all these other people anyway.
Yeah.
Who I think will be privileged to meet you, to be honest.
Oh, nice.
So anyway, it's been fantastic to meet you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And this is your first ever interview. I very much doubt it's your last, but when you're doing really big national stuff, just remember where it all started.
Yeah, that's it.
We will do. Thank you.
Thanks very much, guys.
Cheers.